and features Max Lucado as he spoke to over 50,000 men at Promise Keepers 96 at the Carrier Dome in Syracuse, New York.
In just a minute, I want to talk to you about the people who have hurt you. And in just a minute, I want to give you three reasons for you to forgive the people who have hurt you. I want to talk to you about your past, and I want to talk to you about your present, and I want to talk to you about your future. In just a minute, I want you to open your Bibles to page 22 and read with me a parable found in Matthew, the 18th chapter. But before I do that, I want to give you an invitation. Randy Phillips read earlier from 2 Chronicles 7:14, "If my people, who are called by my name, are sorry for what they have done, if they pray and obey me and stop their evil ways, I will hear them from heaven, I will forgive their sin, and I will heal their land." It has been a burden that God has laid upon my heart to enlist as many prayer warriors as possible for 40 days of prayer, the 40 days prior to the presidential election in November. I'm looking for thousands and thousands of people who will commit to, with me to be a prayer partner every day on behalf of our nation, beginning September 27th, running right up to the election. I'm looking for people who will volunteer to commit themselves to fervent, daily prayer, to fast at least one time during those 40 days, and to lift our nation up to God during those crucial hours, the 40 days prior to the election. And I'm wondering if I would have any volunteers here. If so, I want you to write down a phone number. 1-800-822-9673. 1-800-822-9673. Monday through Friday from 8 a.m. till 5 p.m. Central Standard Time, we have that 800 line dedicated to receiving the calls of thousands of Americans who want to receive a prayer card, a prayer guide, and be prayer partners. The healing of the land begins with the prayers of the saints. The healing of the land begins with the prayers of the saints. Speaking of prayer, I want to go ahead and tell you that at the end of this lesson, we're going to have a special time of prayer. We're going to have anybody here this afternoon who has trouble forgiving someone. If there is bitterness in your heart, if there's anger towards someone, if you have malice, if you have nursed a grudge, we are going to offer a very important prayer, a strategic prayer of healing and deliverance. Maybe the reason you've been able to forgive somebody is because you've tried to do it on your own. I would suggest to you that forgiveness is a work of the Holy Spirit and that you must be prayed over before you can forgive. And so keep that in mind. And we're praying that God will examine your heart during this message and bring to mind anyone against whom you harbor anger or bitterness or a grudge. And for a text to guide us in this study, we're going to look at Matthew chapter 18. It's on page 22, beginning in verse 21. We're going to read the text, then we're going to say a prayer, and then we're going to get to work. Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, "Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother when he sins against me? Up to seven times?" Jesus answered, "I tell you, not seven times, but 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt." Verse 26. The servant fell on his knees before him. "Be patient with me," he begged. "I will pay back everything." The servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and let him go. But when that servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. He grabbed him and began to choke him. "Pay back what you owe me," he demanded. His fellow servant fell to his knees and begged him, "Be patient with me and I will pay you back." But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. When the other servants saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed and went and told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. "You wicked servant," he said. "I canceled all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you?" In anger, his master turned him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back all he owed. And then Jesus offers this commentary. "This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother from your heart." I have three reasons for you to forgive your brother from your heart. I'll mention them several times, but if you want to go ahead and note them, please do. Number one, your past is pardoned. Your past is pardoned. Number two, your present is precious. Your present is precious. And number three, your future needs grace. Everything about your past, your present, and your future cries out for you to forgive those who have offended you. Your past is pardoned. Your present is too precious. And your future needs grace. And so, Father, we lift this lesson up to you. It's going to be tough, Father. We're hot. We're tired. We just ate. Some of us didn't sleep much last night. It's going to be hard. Father, our first prayer is that you would just keep us awake. Our first prayer is that our neighbor would elbow us if we fall asleep. Our first prayer is that Satan would not use our weariness to distract us from your truth. Father, some of us need to be healed today. We're weary of carrying around these wounds of yesterday's hurts. Father, would you please come and be working in this audience, examining hearts, revealing the past, and calling us face to face with your word, which says that we should forgive our brother. Through Jesus we pray. And all God's people said, I need to talk to you about these people who have hurt you. I need to talk to you about that person that you don't like. I need to talk to you about that father who was not there to raise you. I need to talk to you about your wife who said, "I do," one time and said, "I don't," the next time. I need to talk to you about the kids who don't respect you. I think I need to talk to you about your parents who expect too much of you. I need to talk to you about that person. God is bringing him to your mind even as we speak, isn't he? Not only do I need to talk to you about that person, I need to talk to you about those people, whomever they are. I don't know why you don't like them. You may not even know why you don't like them. But some of you have an anger toward a certain religious group. You have it inbred, or maybe you earned it on your own. But you don't like a Baptist. You have an attitude about a Presbyterian. There's something about Episcopalians you just can't tolerate. And Catholics really get to you. I need to talk to you about that. I also need to talk to you about racism. I need to talk to you about that tendency that you have when you see a person of a certain skin color to make certain judgments. I need to talk to you about that tendency that you have when you get to certain neighborhoods to drive around the neighborhoods. I need to talk to you about that tendency that you have that when you see certain people in certain sections of certain cities, you immediately dismiss them or categorize them or blame them. I need to talk to you about that clenched fist. I need to talk to you about that tight throat. I need to talk to you about that dry mouth that surfaces when you see people. I need to talk to you about walls. I need to talk to you about walls of hatred, walls of pride, and walls of prejudice. And I need to talk to you about walls that exist in houses, in the nation, and most tragically, walls that exist in God's kingdom. I am convinced that the greatest sin of our generation is not the immorality of society, but the disunity of the church. It does not please God to see His people warring and squabbling with each other. On the night before His crucifixion, our Lord prayed that they might be one. He told His disciples, if you love one another, then people will know that you are My disciples. Not if you agree with each other or if you're unanimous on every point, but that if you love each other. So we need to talk about these attitudes that exist between groups. We need to understand that God's grace makes three important proclamations. First of all, God's grace announces that God loves you. He could not love you more than He does right now. If you're better tomorrow, God will not love you more tomorrow. Did you know that? If you're worse tomorrow, God will not love you less tomorrow. That is a human love. That's not divine love. A divine love does not come and go, does not ebb and flow. God's grace says, I love you. He doesn't come and leave like the seasons. God's grace says, He loves you. But God's grace says, number two, He loves them. He loves those others around you with the same intensity and the same devotion. He is not a God of partiality. He has not singled out one group, one person, one creed, one denomination, or one race. There is no difference in the intensity of His love for this people as for the intensity He feels right now for people in Australia or Africa or any other part of the world. It's a universal, unbridled, passionate, driving love. He loves you, He loves them. And then number three, God wants you to love them. He wants you and me to accept them like He accepted us. Jesus was asked, what is the greatest commandment? He said, you should love the Lord your God with all of your heart and all of your soul and all of your mind and all of your strength. And the second, He says, though they did not ask for two, the second, He says, is you should love your neighbor as you love yourself. Don't we wish He had not have added that second one? Wasn't it easier when it was just, love the Lord your God? Something distant, something stained glass, something cloudy and nebulous. But Jesus, in adding that second one, says, we know the way you love God by the way you love your people. Later on, one of His followers would actually write, how can you say that you love God that you've never seen if you don't love the fellow who lives down the street? Loose translation. Not easy, but mandatory. How does that old verse go? To live above with those we love, oh, how that will be glory. But to live below with those we know, now that's another story. It's not easy to love people because some people are impossible to please. I remember when I was in college, I had a girlfriend. I took her home to meet my mother, and my mother didn't like her, so I took her back. I found another girl and took her home, and mom didn't like her, so I took her back. Found another girl, took her home, same story, I took her back. I went through a dormitory full of girls, and I couldn't find anybody that my mom liked until finally I found one girl that I knew my mother would like. She looked like my mother. She talked like my mother. She walked like my mother. I took her home. My dad couldn't stand her, so I took her back. Not only is it hard to love people because they're hard to please, it's hard to love some people because they have hurt us so much. I don't know who came up with the phrase, sticks and stones may break my bones, but they've never been called a redhead or skinny or dopey. They've never been called irresponsible by their spouse. They've never been called a drunkard by their society. Words hurt. Consequently, we have been hurt. Consequently, of all of the things that we have in common, every single one of us has an injury. We have been hurt by some person. And my question, friends, this afternoon is, what are you going to do with your hurts? What are you going to do with your hurts? You can either allow your hurts to be healed, or you can allow your hurts to become hates. You cannot choose whether or not you are going to be hurt. That was not optional. But you now can choose what you do with your hurts. So what we're wrestling with right now is, am I going to allow my hurts to be healed, or am I going to live forever with my hurts and allow them to become hates? In 1982, a 17-year-old boy by the name of Kevin Tennell was driving a car while under the intoxication of alcohol. His car struck a car of an 18-year-old girl. She was killed and he was sentenced to serve some time in prison. The family of the victim sued him for $1.5 million but settled for $936 to be paid $1 a week every Friday for 18 years. Every Friday, because it was on a Friday that their daughter was killed, 18 years, 1 year for every year of her life. Kevin Tennell served his prison sentence. He served his required time as a spokesman against drunk driving, even volunteered for extra time. But four different times he has been taken to court for failure to comply. He says he is haunted by the task of taking his checkbook and writing the girl's name, filling in $1, and mailing it to the family. Four different times they've taken him to court for failure to submit the check. It's not a matter of money. He has volunteered to send them more money or to send them all the checks all at once. But it's not the money the family seeks. It's penance. Now, few would question the anger and the hurt of the family. Only the naive would allow the guilty to go unpunished. But I would like to ask one question. Is $936 enough? Is 936 payments enough? Not for Kevin Tennell to pay, but for the family to receive. I'm wondering if in the year 2000, August of 2000, when that final payment comes, will the family finally be released from their anger? Will they suddenly experience a surge of contentment? How many payments are enough? How many payments would you demand of somebody? Better stated, how many payments do you demand? Say, Max, nobody's writing me a check. Well, yes, they are. We have our own ways. They speak, we don't speak back. They come, we go the other direction. They ask a question, we don't respond. We're writing a check, or we're having them write a check. We're dipping into their contentment account. We're asking them to write a check of happiness. If we can just spoil 1 minute, if we can soil one Friday. You see, revenge has but one aim. I have been injured, I want you to be injured too. You hurt me, I hurt you back. And I want you to hurt as much as I hurt, and I also want you to hurt when I hurt. And so every time I see you, I try to bring hurt out of you, and I feel better until I see you again, or until I'm reminded of your accident or your attack again. You may have heard the story of the soldiers in the Korean War, who enlisted the help of a young Korean boy to work in their house. He did cooking and he did some cleaning, and the soldiers did a lot of teasing. They played practical jokes on the boy. They put buckets of water over the doorway. They nailed his shoes to the ground. They put glue on the chair. But the kid never got angry. He never got upset. And they were amazed. So amazed that they became remorseful, and they brought the boy in and they said, "We're sorry, we've kind of gone overboard. And he said, "Oh, does that mean you no more put water?" And they said, "Right." They said, "Does that mean you'll no longer put glue in my shoe?" And they said, "Right." They said, "Does that mean no more nails?" And they said, "Right." He said, "Good, then I no longer put spit in soup." We get creative in our vengeance, don't we? Revenge has that aim. You hurt me, I'll hurt you, and maybe I'll feel better. Revenge reminds me of the nick I got in my windshield some weeks back. Driving down a country road in Texas, some pickup truck passed me and threw a rock up and hit my windshield. Left a nick. A nick became a tributary. The tributary became a winding spider web. And within a few days, my whole front windshield was a spider web of fragments. I couldn't get in my car. I couldn't see out my windshield without thinking of the guy who threw the rock in my windshield. I couldn't see. Every time I looked, every time I opened my eyes, I thought of him. Now, friends, I have never met him, but I know him. He's a jerk. He drives with a six-pack between his legs and a loaded rifle. He beats his wife. He keeps the television on too loud at night. See what he did for the vision that I have? Didn't do much for my windshield either. Revenge clouds the vision of the person until vengeance becomes the overwhelming desire. I want to give you three reasons now why you need to forgive. Three reasons and then I'll be finished. Number one, according to the story that Jesus tells, your past has been pardoned. Reason number one, your past has been pardoned. Verse 27, the servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and let him go. You see, here was a man who had a debt that was insurmountable. You don't need to try to understand the currency described in Matthew 18. Just believe me when I say that if the man could pay $1,000 a day for the rest of his life, he could not begin to repay the debt. It was an impossible debt that he owed to the king. And the king wanted to collect that debt, but the man said, "Have mercy on me." And the king had compassion on him and canceled the debt. Now, unless you miss the point, that's you in this story. That's you. What God has done for you, He did in this story for this man. He canceled your debt. Psalm 103:10 says, "He has not punished us as we should be punished." And aren't you glad? What if God demanded payment? What if God came up to you and said, "You know, you've got a couple of good eyeballs there, and those eyes have looked twice where they never should have looked once. Why don't you just give me one of them? Those hands of yours that I gave you have touched things and people that they never should have touched. I think I'll take a few fingers. Those feet have walked into circles or walked into areas that I urged you to avoid. Could I have a few toes?" You see, if God exacted punishment, if God treated us like our sins deserve to be treated, we would be maimed if we were even alive. But God has come and done for us what the king did for him. He canceled the debt. Remember what James Ryle told us last night? He has taken us and he has buried us, wrapped us up in his son. Galatians 3:27 says, "Don't you know that all of you who have been baptized into Christ have been clothed with Christ?" You've been cloaked with Christ. You're wrapped in Christ. So much so that you now carry the righteousness of Christ. That's an incredible thought. But that's true. 2 Corinthians 5:21. He who had no sin became sin for us. So that in Him, we could become the righteousness of God. When you look in the mirror, you see you. But when God looks in the mirror, He sees His Son. He sees the righteousness of His Son. He has canceled your debt and He has set you free. Now, how does that help you forgive? With this right here, folks. You will never forgive any person more than God has already forgiven you. You will never You will never forgive any person more than God has already forgiven you. I don't want to minimize any pain that's been brought into your life. I don't want to even sound like what that person did was right, or I'm justifying the actions of that group. But what I am saying is, you will never be called to give more grace than you have already received. You can forgive because your past is pardoned. And you can forgive, number two, because your present is precious. Did you see what happened to this man once he was forgiven by the king? He went out and found a man who owed him the equivalent of a few dollars. And because he had not learned how to transfer the grace he had been given to the person who needed it, he choked the man who owed him a few dollars and put him in prison. Irresponsible, illogical hatred. How does he expect the man to pay him back while he's in prison? Hatred never makes sense. And hatred always ends up hurting the person who hates more than the person who is hated. A friend of mine told me he recently saw an old episode of Amos and Andy. Remember the show? And Amos was mad because a friend of his kept irritating him when he would talk. Apparently, this friend would come up and poke him in the chest every time he talked to Amos. And Amos was just tired of it. So Andy said, "What are you going to do about it?" He said, "Well, I've got a bottle of nitroglycerin, and I'm going to tie it around my neck. And the next time he comes up and pokes me on the chest, his finger's going to blow off." You see, when we try to get even, we end up hurting ourselves more than the person who originally hurt us. Why? Because we do not know how many payments to demand. "Vengeance is mine, says the Lord. I will repay." He takes us out of that economy because we do not know what is fair. And He leaves that job up to us. He tells us to not exact payments because what happens is we get addicted. Hear this. We get addicted to hatred. Hatred is a bad addiction. It starts off innocently enough. We indulge our hurts with a needle full of anger. The rush numbs and we feel better, and so we go back for more and we up the dosage. And not only are we mad at what he did, now we're mad at who he is. And we set out not just to speak about the act, but the person. We shame him. We ridicule her. We mock them. We make fun of them. And gradually, but very significantly, we who were the victims for just a moment become the victors. We're over them in our sarcasm, over them in our anger, over them. And it feels so good that soon we hate that person. Our hurt becomes a hate. And not only do we hate that person, listen to this, we hate anybody who's like that person. "All preachers are hucksters," we say. "All women are irresponsible. All people of that background can't be counted on. You can't trust people from Texas." We just make these sweeping, categorizing statements because we're addicted to the hatred, and soon the hurt becomes the hate becomes the rage, and we become junkies, unable to make it through the day without mainlining on bigotry and bitterness. Now, friend, is that how you want to lead your life? You say, "Max, it's hard for me to forgive this person." I know it is, but what option do you have? Came across a letter some years back of a woman who thought her revenge could bring release, but she learned otherwise. And she wrote this letter. "I caught my husband making love to another woman. He swore it would never happen again. He begged me to forgive him, but I could not. I would not. I was so bitter and incapable of swallowing my pride that I could think of nothing but revenge. I was going to make him pay, and pay dearly. I'd have my pound of flesh. I filed for divorce, even though my children begged me not to. Even after the divorce, my husband tried for 2 years to win me back. I refused to have anything to do with him. He had struck first, now I was striking back. All I wanted was to make him pay. Finally, he gave up. and married a lovely young widow with a couple of small children. He began rebuilding his life without me. I see them occasionally, and he looks so happy. They all do. And here I am, a lonely, old, miserable woman who allowed her selfish pride and foolish stubbornness to ruin her life. If you went to the physician on Monday and he told you there was a cancerous tumor in your body, your first response would be, "How can I get it out?" For some of you, the Holy Spirit is speaking to your heart saying there's a cancerous tumor in your soul. A cancerous tumor that will consume you if you don't get it out. A tumor of bitterness, anger, malice, and hatred. Is that really how you want to spend the rest of your life? Do you really want to spend the rest of your life trying to get even? Do you really want to spend the rest of your life demanding that people write checks to you? You know what you learn when you forgive somebody? When you forgive somebody, you learn that when you open the door and let them out, the real prisoner was yourself. And you're the one who walks free. The third reason you need to forgive is that your future needs grace. These are haunting words that Jesus uses at the end of the story that don't need to be taken lightly. "This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother from your heart." Say, "Max, what does that mean?" That means that Christ will leave you in a prison, just like the king left that man in a prison. God will leave you in that prison of anger, that prison of bitterness, and you'll lose what He so much wants you to have, and that's the abundant freedom of life. You will never be called to give more grace than you have already been given. At this time, we're going to have a very special prayer. This is a prayer of deliverance. It's not a timid prayer. It's not a bold prayer. But it's a prayer of the heart. James tells us that if we confess our sins to each other, we will be healed. If you have trouble forgiving someone, I would like to ask you to confess that by standing and allowing us to lead a prayer on your behalf. There's bitterness in your heart toward a person, toward a people, toward a church. If you confess your sins one to another, you will be healed. Healing begins right here. Blessed Father, these who have stood agree with you that anger is not right. These who have stood agree with you that they have received grace and they need power to give that grace to others. But Father, while we stand, we confess we cannot do it alone. We cannot do it without you. We do not have the power nor the strength. The hurt is too deep, Father. The wounds have been there too long. The hatred and the animosity is so ingrained within us, Father, we don't even know where to begin. Oh, blessed Father, we confess to you our sin. Please, Holy Spirit, come with your tender mercy. Shower upon us wisdom and courage and understanding. Father, may your blessings be upon these who have stood. They are walking out of the jail cell of anger and bitterness. They are turning their back on the prisons of pride, and they are breaking down walls. Even with their standing, they are breaking down walls, Father. Now, Father, please give them the courage to take the next step. Give them the courage to write the letter. Give them the courage to make the call. Give them the courage to take the stand. Give them the courage to say, "I'm sorry." Set them free, Father. The truth has come. Now let the truth set them free. As only you can do. You are holy, and you are righteous, and you are true. You saw our sins and forgave us. You saw the sins we have not even committed, and you have forgiven us. And so, Father, the same mercy that we have received, we now turn in abundance. And we, with our mind's eye, picture that person we need to forgive. And we say with our lips, I forgive them. Say it with me, those of you who are standing. I forgive them. I forgive them. I forgive them. Before you, Father, we forgive them. We forgive the father who wasn't there to raise us. We forgive the children who never call us. Father, we forgive the wife who can't remember us. Father, we forgive those people who have mistreated us because of our skin color. Those who have ignored us because of our background. Begin, Father, this journey of forgiveness today. That may there be that moment in eternity that we look back and see that that journey began with the gift of your Holy Spirit coming in this hour. We praise you and worship you, O God of mercy. Through Jesus we pray, and all God's people said,